just want to start this service with a reading of scripture. It says, I lift my eyes up to the mountains. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. He will not let our foot slip or slumber. He who watches over you will not slumber. The Lord watches over you. The Lord will be your shade at your right hand, so that the sun will not harm you by day or the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all harm, and he will watch over your life. The Lord will watch over your coming and your going, both now and forevermore. We want to thank you for being here to celebrate a special life, the life of Eric Ellis. And as we begin, let's take a moment and pray together. Our Heavenly Father, we come to you today because you are the author of life. You are the maker of heaven and earth. You are the one who breathed life into our lungs and who sustains us, and the one who has eternity for us, Father. And we're thankful for the gift of eternal life that comes through your Son, Jesus Christ. Father, we come to you today and we thank you for being with us. We thank you that you're a God who never leaves us or forsakes us, that, Father, you are always with us, especially in these times of difficulty. And as your word says, even when we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, we don't have to fear evil because you are with us. So thank you for being with us today. Thank you for being with Susie, with Bobby, with Erica, with the family, Father. And thank you that, Lord God, we can count on you to give us a hope and a future and to bring us peace. And we thank you for all this in the name of your Son, Jesus, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Well, we want to start, and if you did not get one of the programs, you can grab one on your way out, but this is really well written by Susie's sister, and just want to thank you for that, because we're going to read this obituary. You can follow along if you'd like, or you can just enjoy the words here. I know I did when I looked at it, because I think it captures really well who Eric was. Eric Carlton Ellis, 51, was born on August 16, 1972, in Oklahoma City, Oklahoma. He passed away peacefully in his sleep on May 31, 2024, in Newbury Park, California. First of all, Eric would be irritated to have all of this attention on him. I totally agree with that. I thought he would be upset if I wore a suit, but I did anyways. He was introverted and a homebody. He basically wanted to be left alone. He'd been a grumpy old man since he was a teenager. Stubborn, opinionated, get off my lawn energy, and he unapologetically embraced those traits. He was who he was. But Eric's gruff exterior masked a truly funny and helpful guy. He had a good heart, and he loved his family, and he cared for his friends. He leaves a vast empty space in his absence. Now, Eric had his daughter Erica when he was only 18. And after it didn't work out with Erica's mom, Eric and Susie became high school sweethearts. And Bobby came along several years later. Eric and Susie were together for 30 years. And although ultimately they decided to part ways 2 years ago, he still lived in the same house so that he could be there for Bobby. Eric had a sarcastic sense of humor, and he loved to tease and pull pranks. He'd often joke around with Erica, and he and Bobby would pull pranks on each other. He liked the type of sophisticated humor found in South Park and Beavis and Butthead, and he was the kind of guy who tried to embarrass his friends and loved ones by making fart sounds in their vicinity. But that just meant he liked you. His favorite band was Metallica. I think everybody knows that. And he thought most other music sucked. He was a fan of Star Trek franchises and interested in space exploration. He even had his home office painted black and covered with stars and nebulas. His main food groups were pizza, barbecue, and Dr. Pepper. He was an animal lover and had many furry friends over the years. He was devastated when he lost his best friend, Dobie, the Chihuahua, a few years ago. Eric was skilled at working on computers and electrical projects. He earned a bachelor's of applied science and started his career at Zircom, where he was a telecommunications engineer and then at Intel. After Intel closed his location, Eric and Susie started their own business together, selling products online. Eric was good at working with his hands, and he did many home improvement projects over the years. He stubbornly insisted on doing things the right way, instead of cutting corners, which meant one project could take months, or even years to finish. He had a big heart and would be the first to help family members and their friends with their own projects, while grumbling and complaining the whole time. After Hurricane Katrina hit, Eric traveled to Texas to volunteer with the Red Cross. Later, he volunteered as unofficial security for Newbury Park First Christian Church, stopping by on his nightly walks to make sure the doors were locked and the buildings were secure. Eric was pretty active when he was younger. He looked forward to Halloween, decorating the house with spooky details and scaring the little kids. He enjoyed camping with his friends and family, hiking through Sycamore Canyon down to the beach, making annual trips to Las Vegas for Consumer Electronics Show, going on vacations to Catalina and Yellowstone with Susie and Bobby, and whitewater rafting in Wyoming, riding ATVs and zip lining in British Columbia, Canada, and bowling and playing pool in his and Susie's game room. Sadly, Eric suffered from rheumatoid arthritis, and he was often in pain and had a hard time managing it. In more recent years, he wasn't able to be as active as he once was, but he enjoyed online gaming and as an escape and often played PlayStation 5 with Bobby and with his friends across the country. Eric is survived by his daughter, Erica, Ruth, son, Robert, Bobby, Ellis, his mother, Gloria, Jan, Sherman, ex-wife, Susie Ellis, sister, Allison Basile, brothers, Keith, Rocky Ruman, and Craig Ruman, sisters-in-law, Nancy and Mark Cantor, Elizabeth Wayne Engel, and Deborah Cantor, and brothers-in-law, Tim and Angela Cantor, and David Cantor, and he was preceded in death by his father, Richard Thornton. I want to read for you now something that was written by Eric's daughter, Erica. And wanted to encourage you too, while I'm reading this, is as you think of memories, in just a few moments, we'll take some time for others to share any thoughts and memories that they have. So if you have some of those that you would like to share, be thinking about those, and then I'll bring the microphone to you and you can share some of those stories. We think the stories are really important because these are things, especially for Bobby, for Erica to remember, and the stories that they can hear about their dad. So I'm going to start off by reading this from Erica. She says, "Thank you all for being here today to honor and remember my dad. It means a lot to our family to see you gathered here and to share his memory with us. Dad had a unique sense of humor and loved practical jokes. I will miss his playful spirit. He was unapologetically himself. He loved retelling the story of the time that he hid a noise machine under my pillow. He waited until I was almost asleep to set it off, causing me to jump and to smack into the wall. He would always burst into laughter as he reenacted the thud that I made. He also loved to tease. He would never let me live down the legacy I left behind on our trip to Disney World. One of the things I loved was his ability to turn an ordinary moment into a hilarious memory. For instance, I remember the time that we went hiking and got stuck in thick, sticky mud. I ended up getting so stuck that I fell in face first. The drive home was spent laughing and blasting the Cranberries and Metallica. Some of my favorite memories are when he introduced me to his hobbies, such as going to the Lord of the Rings and Star Wars prequels in the theaters. He also sparked my love for video games from our night of playing X-Men Legends and Unreal Tournament. I wish that I had created more recent memories, but I am grateful for the moments of laughter that I can look back on. My dad's influence on my life through his humor, passions, and memories we shared will stay with me. He will be missed, but remembered with love and laughter. So is there any other stories that you would like to share? I mean, I'll be happy to come and bring the microphone to you.
Hey everyone, I'm Tim, I'm Susie's brother, and Eric and I would describe him as a longtime friend. Yeah, he was my brother-in-law. I could also describe him as the brother, the older brother that no one really wanted. And I mean that more as a compliment if you know Eric. Eric was that, he was like a bully, but not really a bully. Like, when he was picking on you as Nancy so eloquently described in the obituary, he was picking on you because he liked you. If he didn't like you, he wouldn't pick on you. He wouldn't talk to you. He wouldn't give you the time of day, other than perhaps to complain about you behind your back. But Eric was a lot of fun to be around when you were on his good side. And I had my moments where I was not on his good side. But then I think over the years I was able to redeem that a little bit, and we had a lot of fun together. We went on a vacation together, and one of my funniest memories with Eric was my brother David and I and Eric decided we wanted to go on a man trip. So we planned out this whole thing where we were whitewater rafting and riding ATVs, and we stopped in Las Vegas, and we did all these different things. And all three of us together would constantly try to mess with each other the entire trip. And one time we were walking through one of the halls at a casino in Las Vegas, and David, my brother, says to me, "Should I try to kiss Eric on the cheek?" And of course I said, "Yes, definitely, you should try that." So unbeknownst to me, Eric, I guess, maybe suspected something. So David went in to give Eric a kiss on the cheek, which would have been pretty benign, but Eric turned at the last second and stuck out his tongue and licked David from his chin to his forehead, with David's lips puckered. I fell on the ground laughing. It was so hilarious. David was like, sorry, I can still picture his face now. David was just wiping his face. Eric was wiping his tongue. It was just a great memory. As Nancy also pointed out, there's so many things that when I was reading the obituary, I think we all knew that Nancy was going to do an excellent job at that because Nancy knows words very well and she describes so many perfect aspects about Eric. And when I was reading that, it just kept making me think about all the times when he refused to help and then would show up at your house to help. Or said that stupid, do it yourself, go hire someone, and then 10 minutes later would be there. Or the other times when there was a genuine emergency, like one time when my mom burned herself with some scalding water, I think it was within minutes that he was at our door with Susie to make sure my mom was okay. He would always be there for his family and his friends, and he would never hesitate to be there for his family and his friends, even if he didn't want to be there, which he made perfectly known to everyone. So I actually had not seen Eric too much. As Nancy mentioned, he was a bit of a homebody, more so in his the last 4 or 5 years or so, and I hadn't gotten a chance to hang out with him other than just see him every now and then. He just didn't get out to visit people very often anymore. And he went to watch Bobby, his son, test for his next belt in the martial arts where Bobby's training. And I went there also and was sitting down next to Eric after my first time seeing him in quite a few years. And it was, after not seeing him for several years, it was so weird that he was exactly the same person he has always been. He was still making the same jokes. I believe he actually quoted Beavis and Butthead. No, he definitely did, now that I think back on it. It was just who he was and how he acted. There was no difference. He was always the same person. He was someone that you can for sure count on that he will be the same person that he always was, for better or for worse. And he will be very much missed because he does leave a hole in our lives for the man that he was.
Hi. Is it on? I'm Tessa, if you don't know. I've known Eric and Susie for a long time, since Erica was a little girl. And she used to be friends with my daughter, Amy. And about 10 years ago, I had a series of really, really awful things. And sorry, I didn't know I was going to do the cry. But lost my daughter, lost her father, and I was have cancer. And when my daughter's father died, he left a house that was just horrendous. Hoarder's house, to the roof of all kinds of stuff. And I didn't know what to do. And I don't know how he got there, but here came Eric. And he literally worked on that house, stayed in the house. He slept there at night. He helped me for 6 months. He was there all the time. He helped sort that stuff. He helped clean that stuff. He helped sell the stuff. And even when I knew that he was hurting and wasn't feeling good, he would say, you know, I can't do this today because I'm hurting and stuff. But then he would be there, you know, at midnight working away. And I honestly don't know what I would have done without him. He was a really good friend to me. And I loved his crusty humor because I would come in the mornings. I was with the day crew. He was the night crew. And find funny notes on stuff. Little things, you know, just I loved his sense of humor too. And like everybody else says, when he wasn't grumbling, and he was grumbling a lot, but he was still really funny, and he had a heart of gold underneath that. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else want to share anything? All right, well, we'll have some time a little bit later together so you can share some of those other memories. I wanted to share just a little bit. You know, it's interesting. Eric and I had kind of a unusual relationship of sorts. I'm going to turn this one off and go back to that one, I think. So, Eric was our night watchman here at church. One of the things that I remember the most, the first time I met Eric, though, was we had a Saturday evening service. And Eric would come to Saturday evening service with Susie. And there was a time when, you know, they were there pretty regularly. And I got to know Eric kind of at a distance, but kind of always wondered, like, he seemed like, you know, standoffish, right? It took a while to kind of get to know who he was. When we stopped having the Saturday night service, though, he definitely let me know right away how upset he was that we weren't doing that anymore. But then one night, I had come here to church because oftentimes I'd be here at night, whether I was in my office studying or things were going on or we were cleaning up after events. And I would be leaving the premises or moving from one building to another. And at the most crazy moments, I would turn a corner, and there was Eric, right? Like, late at night, it's dark on the campus, and everybody knows how much he loved Metallica. When I found that out, it made a lot of sense, because here was Eric late at night in, like, these dark sweat or dark shorts, and a dark sweatshirt with a hood on, walking around the campus, and he'd kind of come out of nowhere and scare me to death. I was like, oh my gosh, where'd this guy come from? And I could almost just see that funny grin. Like, it was almost like he's going, oh good, I got him, right? Like, oh good, I scared him. That was kind of the thing, right? And it just happened over and over again. I mean, one night I was leaving and I'm starting to drive out the parking lot and he literally jumps out by the bushes right up here and you know, scares me to death while I'm driving my truck. And I was like, oh my gosh, what are you doing, right? Well, I knew what he was doing. He was doing what he did every night. He would come and he took what he did very seriously. He'd check every door at the church to make sure everything was locked up. And nights I would leave the other way and I would see a light on in the gym, like you could see just barely through the doors, and I'd go in and Eric would be going back and forth and back and forth with this dust mop in our gymnasium, just like cleaning the floor over and over and over again. And I said, Eric, how many times have you done that this week? He goes, well, I've done it like 3 times this week. I said, well, Eric, you don't need to clean. And he says, no, I have to. And he'd always say, I have to keep moving. I have to keep moving, right? It hurts if I don't move. And that's what he would tell me. And as I think about Eric, I think his life, Eric was just, he was a paradox. Right? I mean, he was like, and I thought you described it so well. He was both like grumpy, but happy. It's like, how do you work those things together, right? He could be like at sometimes just very, very short with you. And at times you could just see that. I mean, I didn't even know that he had gone to help after the hurricanes. But he was both a person that wanted to do something, loved helping other people, but at times he would just tell you like it is, right? Now, sometimes he would, you know, there were so many times where you absolutely knew what he was thinking because he would just tell you, right? And if he didn't tell you, I think like Tim said, it meant he either didn't know you or didn't like you, right? So, but Eric was unique, but aren't we all? And I love those descriptive words, you know. And I remember, you know, that he wandered around the church long enough that we finally just kind of gave him a job title, right? You're the night watchman. And we even gave him a set of keys, which is hard around here to get a set of keys, right? And so, but Eric got a set of keys so that he could, like, make sure things were locked and make sure things were taken care of. And I have to say, it was great knowing that Eric was always around. You know, you never knew when, you never knew how, but he was always there, and he was just so consistent that way. And along the way, we had some very interesting conversations. Usually at night, when he was walking around and I would stop. I remember even right after Bobby was born, I remember a couple times, you know, he was down even pushing a stroller around the place. I was like, wow, like that's amazing. But he just wanted to be with Bobby, right? And Bobby was with him and he just kept doing his thing. And I grew to appreciate Eric's unique wit and sense of humor, his sarcasm, but most of all, the heart of a guy who truly did love his family, loved his friends, and loved his God. And, you know, as I think about passages of scripture that I think mean a lot, you know, that remind me of Eric, the first is in John chapter 14 that I think brings us some comfort in times like this. It says, "Don't let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me," Jesus said. "My Father's house, there are many rooms. If that were not so, I would have told you that I am going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back to take you to be with me so that you also may be where I am." And that confidence that we can have in life after this one, in our eternal home. And I think that is so important. Because when I think of Eric, the other thing I think of is persistence in the face of pain. You know, I think that as I talked to Eric more and more and he shared, you know, it started to make sense, you know, some things, some of those little idiosyncrasies about Eric when he would share about the pain and the struggle that he was in. And as I think about that, I think about this incredible scripture from Revelation chapter 21, where it says, "And then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. And I heard a voice from the throne saying, look, God's dwelling place is among his people, and he'll dwell with them, and they will be his people, and God himself will be their God, and he will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and there will be no more death, no more mourning, or crying, or pain. And when I think about that, I think about the hope of no more crying, no more pain, no more mourning, and the fact that Eric right now is free of pain, that there's no more arthritis, you know, that he is completely free of that. And I have no idea what kind of hikes and things that he is on in heaven right now, but I'm sure that he is having a blast. I don't know if he's pulling some practical jokes on some of the angels up there or something like that, but I'm sure that Eric is free from the pain and the brokenness of this life. And that was the problem. I mean, Eric's body was broken, and we all experience that brokenness, but we can find peace because of who Jesus is and the promise that we have of an eternal life where there will be no more suffering and no more pain. And with that, I kept thinking, like, what should I share? And I've shared this before at a couple services that I just thought fit really well, Eric, because he just liked things that were just a little bit different. And so at a celebration of life service, I thought one thing I would read that might be appropriate was written by the great theologian Dr. Seuss. And Dr. Seuss says this, if you've ever read his book, Oh, the Places You'll Go, it says this, and I thought this just applies really well to Eric. It says, congratulations, which is kind of a paradox, right? It's like not a word you would say at a service like this. But congratulations, today is your day. You are off to great places. You're off and away. You have brains in your head. You have feet in your shoes. And you can steer yourself any direction you choose. You're off on your own, and you know what you know, and you are the guy who will decide where to go. I thought, man, that just really describes Eric perfectly. Then it goes on and says, out there, things can happen, and frequently do, to people as brainy and footsie as you. And then when things start to happen, don't worry, don't stew, just go right along, because you'll start happening too. Oh, the places you will go. You'll be on your way up. You'll see the great sights. You'll join the high flyers, and you will soar to high heights. You won't lag behind because you've got the speed. You'll pass the whole gang, and you'll soon take the lead. Wherever you fly, you'll be the best of the best. Wherever you go, you will top all the rest. Oh, the places you'll go. And I think about, oh, the places, the place that he is and the things that he sees, but the fact that he is free from pain and celebrating eternity with the Savior brings peace and hope to our lives. And so before we take a few minutes and have some time to watch Eric's life on some slides, I want to take another minute and pray for us. So would you bow with me? Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for, again, this time to, Father, reflect and to celebrate Eric's life. Lord, we thank you for the unique life that Eric lived. Father, we're thankful for the unique ways that he saw life and shared with us. Father, the honesty with which he lived life and shared with others. He shared what he thought and shared his feelings, and Father, didn't hold back. And Father, but we're also thankful, Father, that he was a life that demonstrated persistence in the face of pain. And Father, we're grateful today that we can be assured that he no longer is in pain, and that, Father, he is celebrating with you. Father, we thank you for that, and we praise you in the powerful name of Jesus, our Savior. Amen.
All right. I've heard there was a secret chord that David played and it pleased the Lord. But you don't really care for music, do you? Well, I it goes like this, the fourth, the fifth, the minor fall, the major lift, the baffled king composing hallelujah. She broke your throne and she cut your hair, and from your lips she drew the hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
as we've said, Eric will leave a vast hole. I think about the things that even he has left here, the holes that he's left for our church. You know, somebody to be around to lock things up. Every year, for years, he would help us lead our hike to the beach. And he was one of those guys that would always be faithfully there for things like that. And the slides made me remember, like even a trip down to Mexico with us and things like that, that he was always finding ways to serve other people. And so on behalf of the family, I want to thank you guys for being here. And I think Erica and Bobby just know that that you guys are loved and that these great memories you can hold on to. And I would say more than anything else is hold on to a faith in Jesus Christ, because the hope that we have, that hope that brings us to a place where there's no longer pain or suffering, where the brokenness is fixed, is because of a faith in the person of Jesus Christ. And because of that, that we know that we can spend eternity together, that this is not the end of the story. And we put our hope and our trust in that. So I want to invite you in just a couple of moments after we pray to head on over. There's a room just across the way here. There's some refreshments, some coffee and water and some goodies over there. And you can spend some time together. And I want to encourage you just keep sharing the stories. Share the stories of Eric's life. Share the things that he meant to you. Share the ways that that we can hold on to that. And remember to keep Bobby and Erica, Susie, the family in your prayers. So let's pray together. Our Heavenly Father, again, Lord, we come to you. And Father, in times such as these, Lord, we realize that you are the one that holds not only this life, but eternity in your hands. That Father, you loved us so much that you gave your Son so that we, through faith in him, could have eternal life. And Father, we thank you for that gift that brings hope, that gift that brings us peace in times that don't always make sense to us. Father, we thank you, Lord God, for Eric's life and the way he impacted others and the things that he did that definitely demonstrated a good and caring heart, Father. And Lord, we just thank you for this time that we have together to celebrate life, because as we celebrate life, Father, we're always celebrating you. And we give you the glory and the honor and the praise, Father, for being the one who not only creates us and sustains us, but gives us hope for eternity. We love you, Lord, and we thank you in the powerful name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. So you can take some time and head on over and spend some time with the family over there. And we just want to thank you again for being here today.